feel very hesitant to fight against it. I think, you know, that we're living in 1930s Germany, and, you know, we're talking about changing race. You know, I feel like it's really, we're in a very, living in a very dangerous time. And if you have any ideas what hold us into.
I can say as a journalist, one of the best small pieces of advice that I give even to friends and neighbors is really to support institutions of journalism that you believe in. I mean, I was, I'll admit, I was so awful at doing this on tape, but I usually used to get them from NPR. And I was not a subscriber to like the New York Times, right? Or the Washington Post, and I finally was like, you, I really need to do this. Plus sometimes, you know, you're like on a different device with the paywall. But a part of it was also for me the idea of, you know, people keep saying where news comes from, and I even have friends on Facebook, and regardless of what their political leanings are, people just post things from blogs and from other, I would say ad hoc organizations that are not news sites, and it bothers me so much because I know what goes into creating a story that actually makes it to air. And there's so much rigor behind all of that. You know, I have not worked at the Times or the Post, but I have colleagues and friends who have. And again, you know the sort of system of checks and balances that are there. And yet, so often, you know, people will try to click whatever supports their preconceived view, regardless, I would say, of what political viewpoint they have. And so I'm a big believer of going to the journalistic institution from its source. I also know a lot of people hate on, you know, sometimes institutions of journalism, that these are sort of big mega entities, but I mean, I believe that there is a system put in place of editors and just a system of rigor that for me is very important. And it troubles me so much how frequently we hear folks blasting the news media because it's this idea of building distrust in the very institution that is trying to present you truth. And when truth becomes very volatile, right, that there are multiple truths right now in the sort of society we live in, I worry about how a democracy can thrive if we can't agree upon like basic truths. I think you can have different points of view on whether or not those truths are, whether or not that truth is correct or good or negative, right? Like what the perceived consequences are. But I think it's very dangerous when, I mean, I had friends posting on Facebook blatant falsehoods after the election. I mean, it would be someone posting about, say, Hillary Clinton lost the popular vote. I mean, these are things that are just like mathematical. I think I have such a quantitative brain that it bothers me so much when I see people who are like, no, 2 + 2 does not equal 5. It equals 4. And it only can equal 4. And when we're dealing with quantitative information, there cannot be multiple correct answers. And it's worrisome to me, but I think that's one very small thing that's very important and valuable to me.
I just think it's really an issue of, you know, everyone has the ability to support civil liberties within their sphere of control. So to me, I mean, Asma is a journalist, so she has the ability to be able to, you know, impact and support civil liberties. You know, I to this day, I'm so, I support that. I really, really appreciative that I'm a leader in my community. And then once that became part of my sphere of control, then I realized something I got to do here. You know, if I've got this assignment, something I can do with it. But I'll tell you that there's so many ways that people are supportive. And really, that was my last line from all this, is that the moment, what's really inspired me has been all of you guys. I mean, like, really, it has been. I mean, you know, Ruth knows that on the wall of our office, like, we've basically posted, like, every card that we've got, a postcard that just encourages us or tells us to keep going.
I've kept every single card because listeners sent so many cards. I don't even know I love this story. Right. It was more like, we know what the campaign's been like.
So we don't say the negative stuff.
Positive stuff. I keep every card.
Yeah.
Like, a man wrote me a letter from jail because apparently public radio is like sometimes what folks listen to there, and I saved the entire letter. I agree. That's an amazingly profound thing. You guys put them up. Let's go to show them up. I just stay safe with that. Seeing them every day would help.
I was struck by your story of a year ago, in which all the people silence the people who observe but say nothing. And I'm wondering, and also maybe this is a place where the media can make some strides. All the people that are saying nothing. You know, I tuned in about 10 minutes of the State of the Union address driving today, and he was on script. As a result, there's a legitimacy that will be attached to him now, and an overlooking of a long year's experience. And yet we watch the people say nothing. Our religious leaders, why do you have to be religious leaders? Why don't you talk to the bishops? Why don't you talk to the evangelical, Catholic, name them? The people who are saying nothing. Because there's so many of them, and this, you know, we may talk, we're all in this room today, we're here probably because we're so motivated. Politicians want to do so much, but the one person that maybe has the opportunity to cut through are the journalists.
I mean, I hope that people listen. I get a little worried that people go to what already supports what they want to hear, and I felt that sometimes in talking to voters. People would be very dismissive of what, you know, a particular news outlet was that a person worked for if you were at a rally, regardless of what that anchor was saying. I mean, we all have seen probably the reports of how CNN was treated throughout the campaign cycle. So I hope that people listen. I mean, I think that what you're saying has value in terms of going to official leaders and asking them their particular stance on things. I worry that overall we've ended up in this sort of information age in which people consistently go to whatever news source.
Well, we allow silence from the religious leaders. We sit here and we allow silence from all the heads of our various...
I mean, the religious leaders to me is interesting, but I would argue again, maybe this goes back to the fact that there are very few people in newsrooms that I know of who are people of faith. I would say one of our colleagues who did a very good job on stuff, I thought was Sarah McCann, because she knew certain evangelical leaders. And she would go to, I mean, she did a story recently on, was it on abortion? I mean, she knows who the players are, and even some players that maybe we don't, players is the wrong word, but actors, you know, who are making the decisions. I don't know that a lot of folks know. I'm sorry?
You gave Tim Dolan prime time on Sunday to rail against women's reproductive rights. Why isn't anyone putting a microphone in front of Tim Dolan and saying, where is the Catholic Church? While every gospel value is being violated. Why isn't he being challenged? He was given so much airtime when they were going down women's rights.
I didn't hear that at all.
He was on the press, he was on every forum.
I mean, a part of it could be, I mean, I'm totally surmising here, but I mean, a lot of news outlets don't even have folks who cover religion. I mean, you have major news outlets who might have a person covering religion, which is the entire being. It's a force that's very powerful for the American public, writ large, but it's not a force that is given priority in the newsrooms. I don't think that's correct, but it's currently the way that, unfortunately, things have gone.
I'm we're gonna start wrapping it up, and Ryan is gonna say something. We can entertain like maybe a couple more questions, but we have a lot of food. But I should have said one thing before we started. I want to acknowledge, I think, the first time that the judiciary celebrated civil liberties and the Constitution Day. Shin Guy back here was one of our first speakers. And I want to acknowledge the fact that we're all here and talking about everything, but there are so many people in our community where the issue of civil liberties is so at stake. And I just want to acknowledge Shin Guy for being here. And thank you.
All
happening internationally, that, that we're losing the respect of the world because we're not necessarily following those things. Yeah, I just think that that's always been the standard there, is that the United States has a strong rule of law, has a strong journalism, and to attack it, I think it's very...
Is that an issue that comes up with your, on your AG talks? Is there anything that at the state level that people feel like that they can do that's protective of our democracy and that can be happening at the federal level?
Right. Well, I mean, I think that's going to be the... Part of me is trying to stay optimistic. Like in other words, I think one of the things that we've always talked about is how what makes the United States a special institution is because it has the checks and balances. So right now, Congress is behaving the way that they are. They can go to the courts, but maybe some other time, general elections, and maybe Congress will be, maybe they'll be the checker or something, or maybe they'll be, that's has to be our faith in perfect system, but what we believe is still the best system.
So we have one more question from Dr. Cornelius, and then Brian Kalamuchi will just close up and
thank you. This word is Khalid. Part of the history of the Japanese American experience was that Japanese Americans stepped up to the plate to do things like undercover work and translation. Question, it doesn't appear, at least we are not aware of,